The following program is a presentation of the Civil War Broadcasting Network, available on the free YouTube channel, General Grant by himself, by Dr. E.C. Fields, on the Facebook page, Kurt Fields as General Ulysses S. Grant, and various other social media. Permission to copy and distribute is granted, and indeed it is encouraged. Remember, you are the future of our past. And now, in the ongoing series of General Grant Looks at the American Civil War, a reflection by General Grant about his relationship with General John A. McClernand and his relieving General McClernand of command of the 13th Corps. I am General of the Army Ulysses S. Grant, and I should like to reflect with you this day about my relationship with General John McClernand and my relieving him of duty from command of the 13th Army Corps. I would like to review with you the General Order No. 151 of October 4th, 1862, which outlines the basis for my relieving General McClernand of command. Part 2 of General Orders No. 151. If any officer shall hereafter, without proper authority, permit the publication of any official letter or report, or allow any copy of such a document to pass into the hands of persons not authorized to receive it, his name will be submitted to the President for dismissal. This rule applies to all official letters and reports written by an officer himself. On June the 13th, I received this communication from General Sherman, and as you can understand, he was quite upset. It's his letter objecting to General Orders No. 72 issued by General McClernand to the 13th Army Corps, read to them, and somehow found its way into newspapers throughout the Midwest and the North. Sir, on my return last evening from an inspection of the new works at Snyder's Bluff, General Blair, that would be General Francis Blair of St. Louis, called my attention to the enclosed publication in the Memphis Evening Bulletin of June 13th instant, entitled Congratulatory Order of General McClernand, with a request that I should notice it, lest the statements of fact and inference contained therein might receive credence from an excited public. It certainly gives me no pleasure or satisfaction to notice such a catalog of nonsense, such an effusion of vainglory and hypocrisy. Nor can I believe General McClernand ever published such an order officially to his corps. I know too well that the brave and intelligent soldiers and officers who compose that corps will not be humbugged by such stuff. If the order be a genuine production and not a forgery, it is manifestly addressed not to an army, but to a constituency in Illinois, far distant from the scene of the events attempted to be described, who might innocently be induced to think General McClernand, the sagacious leader and bold hero he so complacently paints himself. But it is barely possible the order is a genuine one, and was actually read to the regiments of the 13th Army Corps, in which case a copy must have been sent to your office for the information of the commanding general. I beg to call his attention to the requirements of General Orders No. 151 of 1862, which actually forbids the publication of all official letters and reports, and requires the name of the writer to be laid before the President of the United States for dismissal. The document under question is not technically a report or a letter, and though styled an order, is not an order. It orders nothing, but is in the nature of an address to soldiers, manifestly designed for publication for ulterior political purposes. It perverts the truth to the ends of flattery and self-glorification, and contains many untruths, among which is one of monstrous falsehood. It substantially accused General McPherson and myself with disobeying the orders of General Grant in not assaulting on May 19th and 22nd and allowing on the latter day the enemy to mass his forces against the 13th Army Corps alone. General McPherson is fully able to answer for himself and for the 15th Army Corps. I answered that on May 19th and 22nd, it attacked furiously at three distinct points, the enemy's works, at the very hour and minute fixed in General Grant's written order. That on both days we planted our colors on the exterior slope and kept them there till nightfall. That from the first hour of investment of Vicksburg until now, my corps has at all times been far in advance of General McClernand's. That the General-in-Chief, by personal inspection, knows this truth. That tens of thousands of living witnesses beheld and participated in the attack. That General Grant visited me during both assaults and saw for himself, and is far better qualified to judge whether his orders were obeyed than General McClernand, who was nearly 3 miles off. That General McClernand never saw my lines, that he knew and still knows nothing about them, and that from his position he had no means of knowing what occurred on this front. Not only were the assaults made at the time and place and in the manner prescribed in General Grant's written orders, but at about 3 p.m., 5 hours after the assault on the 22nd began, when my storming party lay against the exterior slope of the bastion on my front, and Blair's whole division was deployed close up to the parapet, ready to spring to the assault, and all my field artillery were in good position for the work, General Grant showed me a note from General McClernand, that moment handed him by an orderly, to the effect that he had carried three of the enemy's forts, and that the flag of the Union waved over the stronghold of Vicksburg, asking that the enemy should be pressed at all points lest he should concentrate on him. Not dreaming that a major general would at such a critical moment make a mere bunkum communication, I instantly ordered Giles A. Smith's division and the artillery, deployed as before described, and sent an aide to General Steele about a mile to my right to convey the same mischievous message, whereby we lost needlessly many of our best officers and men. I would never have revealed so unwelcome a truth had General McClernand, in his process of self-flattery, confined himself to facts in the reach of his own observation, and not gone out of the way to charge others for results which he seems not to comprehend. In cases of repulse and failure, congratulatory addresses by subordinate commanders are not common, and are only resorted to by weak and vain men to shift the burden of responsibility from their own to the shoulders of others. I never make a practice of speaking or writing of others, but during our assault of the 19th, several of my brigade commanders were under the impression that McClernand's corps did not even attempt an assault. In the congratulatory order, I remarked great silence on the subject. Merely to satisfy inquiring parties, I should like to know if McClernand's corps did or did not assault at 2 p.m. of May 19th as ordered. I do not believe it did, and I think General McClernand responsible. With these remarks, I leave the matter properly where it belongs, in the hands of the commanding general, who knows his plans and orders and sees with an eye single to success and his country's honor, and not from the narrow and contracted circle of a subordinate commander who exaggerates the importance of the events that fall under his immediate notice and is filled with an itching desire for fame not earned. Well, that was certainly a warm communication and brought the attention, or my attention, to the fact that there had been a 3-page letter published in a number of newspapers without my knowledge and certainly without my permission. I sent to General McClernand this statement: enclosed, I send you what purports to be your congratulatory address to the 13th Army Corps. I would respectfully ask if it is a true copy. If it is not a correct copy, furnish me one by bearer, as required both by regulations and existing orders from the department. Very respectfully, U.S. Grant, Major General. General McClernand replied the next day, June the 13th of 63, Major General Grant, I have just returned. The newspaper slip is a correct copy of my congratulatory order number 72. I am prepared to maintain its statements. I regret that my adjutant did not send you a copy promptly as he ought, And I thought he had, and that would be his adjutant, Lieutenant Colonel Walter B. Skates. He got the blame for it. Having received that and confirmed it was indeed a true copy, on the 17th, to be delivered the next day on the 18th, I wrote the following order. Special Orders number 164. Major General John A. McClernand is hereby relieved from the command of the 13th Army Corps. He will proceed to any point he may select in the state of Illinois and report by letter to the headquarters of the Army for orders. Major General E.O.C. Ord is hereby appointed to the command of the 13th Army Corps, subject to the approval of the President, and will immediately assume charge of the same. Now, that order was delivered at about 2 o'clock in the morning on the 18th of May because Lieutenant Colonel James Wilson had returned late to headquarters, and Rawlins had written that order to be delivered the next day. And James Wilson said, let me take it to him right now. Rawlins said, it is late, wait till in the morning. But Wilson had grown to intensely dislike McClernand, and an incident to illustrate that would be not long after Champion Hill, I had sent orders to General McClernand via Lieutenant Colonel Wilson to move forward and take or support the taking of, I think, Hall's Ferry, a ferry in the area. And McClernand, according to Lieutenant Colonel Wilson, an 1860 West Point graduate, exploded and cursed in such a foul manner, and he's a particularly profane man anyway with a bad temper, and said, I won't do it, and you can go back and tell Grant I'm not going to do it. I'm tired of being pushed around. And went on to curse loud and long me and also West Point graduates. Now, Lieutenant Colonel Wilson said that he sidled his horse over next to Major General McClernand and leaned into him and said, General McClernand, you are soundly cursing General Grant and West Point graduates, and it seems to me that in turn you are cursing me. Now, if that is the case, sir, even though I am but a lieutenant colonel and you a major general, I will pull you off that horse and beat your boots off of you. Whereupon General McClernand restrained himself and said, no, I'm not cursing you. I know you. I served with your father in the Black Hawk War. I'm merely expressing my intense vehemence on the subject. And after Lieutenant Colonel Wilson reported that back to us, it's become a standing joke around headquarters. Anytime we hear somebody cursing, we just say he's expressing his intense vehemence upon the subject. Now, when he got back on the night of the 17th, early morning of the 18th, and found out what was going on, he wanted to go ahead and take that order to Major General McClernand. They also have said since then, he and Rawlins, that they were concerned that there might be some rebel movement and that I would delay the issuing of the order and relieving McClernand of command. It might be that they just wanted to relieve McClernand, and Wilson wanted the pleasure of doing it. So Rawlins said, all right. Wilson got the provost marshal and four privates and took them with him. About 2 o'clock in the morning, he got to Major General McClernand's tent. Sentry said the general's asleep, and Lieutenant Colonel Wilson said, wake him. After an appropriate time, he was called into the tent. Provost marshal and soldiers lined up outside the general's tent. And he told General McClernand, I have orders for you, General, and to stand here and see that you read and understand them. And McClernand read those orders relieving him. And Wilson said, he spontaneously said, by God, I'm relieved. And then he said in the same breath, by God, sir, it seems we are both relieved. Now, we don't know if he meant he and Wilson, or if he meant himself and myself, or perhaps me later on with his political influence, that I would be relieved. That's unknown, but McClernand said, I am relieved, and by God, sir, we're both relieved. In response to that, and he had arisen and put on a full uniform, had a table with two candles and his sword laid upon the table. So it seems he might have expected something of moment to be delivered to him. He replied to me same day, Major General U.S. Grant, Commanding Department of the Tennessee, your order relieving me and assigning Major General Orr to the command of the 13th Army Corps is received. Having been appointed by the President to the command of that corps under a definite act of Congress, I might justly challenge your authority in the premises, but forbear to do so at present. I am quite willing that any statement of fact in my congratulatory order to the 13th Army Corps, to which you think just exception may be taken, should be made the subject of investigation, not doubting the result. Your obedient servant, John A. McClernand. Well, he left and got back to Illinois late September and began a letter-writing campaign to General Halleck, Secretary of War Stanton, Governor Yates, Senator Lyman Trumbull from Illinois, the President himself, a cascade of letters to be restored to command. And he wrote Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln, President of the United States, I have been relieved for an omission of my adjutant. Hear me. Apparently, General McClernand feels he is on an intimate basis with the President to speak to him like that. I sent this letter to Major General, or rather to Brigadier General Lorenzo Thomas, Adjutant General of the Army, June 26th of 63. General, enclosed, I respectfully transmit the letters of Major General W.T. Sherman and Major General J.B. McPherson, respectively, the 17th and 18th instant, June, relative to the congratulatory order, Major General John A. McClernand to his troops, a copy of which order is also herewith transmitted, together with copies of the correspondence relating thereto, and my order relieving General McClernand from command of the 13th Army Corps and assigning Major General Ord to the command thereof, subject to the approval of the President. A disposition and earnest desire on my part to do the most I could with the means at my command, without interference with the assignments to command, which the President alone was authorized to make, made me tolerate General McClernand long after I thought the good of the service demanded his removal. It was only when almost the entire army under my command seemed to demand that he be relieved. The enclosed letters show the feelings of the Army Corps serving in the field with the 13th Corps. The removal of General McClernand from the command of the 13th Army Corps has given general satisfaction, the 13th Army Corps sharing perhaps equally in that feeling with the other corps of the Army. My action in the relieving of Major General John A. McClernand from the command of the 13th Army Corps and the assignment of Major General E.O.C. Ord to that command, I trust, will meet the approval of the President, very respectfully, etc. President Lincoln, on August the 12th of 1863, wrote this letter to General McClernand. All there is, so far as I have heard, is General Grant's statement of his reasons for relieving you. And even this I have not seen or sought to see, because it is a case, as appears to me, in which I could do nothing without important successes, and for me to interfere and thus magnify a breach between you could not but be of evil effect. Better leave it where the law of the case has placed it. For me to force you back upon General Grant would be forcing him to resign. I cannot give you a new command because I have no forces except such as already have commanders. I am constantly pressed by those who scold before they think, or without thinking at all, to give commands respectively to Fremont, McClellan, Butler, Siegel, Curtis, Hunter, Hooker, and perhaps others. When all is out of the way, I have no commands to give them. This is now your case, which, as I have said, pains me not less than it does you. My belief is that the permanent estimate of what a general does in the field is fixed by the cloud of witnesses who have been with him in the field, and that relying on these, he who has the right needs not fear. And that was his final word upon the matter. Now, in closing, I would like to quote these three men. In 1864, General Halleck wrote a letter to General Sherman, quoting him, about political generals. "It seems but little better than murder to give commands to such men as Banks, Butler, McClernand, Siegel, and Lew Wallace, yet it seems impossible to prevent it." And that was as late as 1864. With 187 political generals appointed. In fairness to General McClernand, I should like to say what Lieutenant Colonel James H. Wilson said about him, the man who told him, "I'll beat your boots off if I think you're cursing me," and who wanted to personally deliver his relieving of command order. But Lieutenant Colonel Wilson had this to say about McClernand. "With all his violence of temper and his lack of military training and discipline, he was a patriot and a man of strong, virile character, who with an ordinary degree of self-control would have come out of the war as one of its real heroes. His support of the administration at the outbreak of the rebellion and during the war rendered it a great and valuable political service, second only to that rendered by Douglas. And there can be but little doubt that both the President and Secretary of War were partial to him and had encouraged him with the hope, if not the formal promise, of the command of the expedition to open the Mississippi River." And General McClernand, on November the 23rd of 1864, wrote his retirement letter and left the service. And he said in part, "The personal relations borne towards me by officers in the military service who are my superiors in rank and influence render my future usefulness in my military capacity contingent and uncertain. My retirement from military service would relieve them and me from further embarrassment growing out of these actions." November 23rd, 1864. And General McClernand was no more. I shall reflect one more time on General McClernand and talk about his activities from my relieving him of command in June of 63, his being given another command and sent back to the field in February of 64, even as I was being promulgated in line to become the first lieutenant general. So there is more to the story of General McClernand before he resigned in 1864. And that shall be my next reflection. But until we come together again in the war room or in the library or other place to reflect, I am General of the Army Ulysses S. Grant bidding you a fond adieu.